He's a former teen idol who's never left the showbiz world. At 71, Normie Rowe is showing no signs of slowing down. In fact, the Aussie pop legend has just made a gear change and he's back performing to packed houses in theatres right across the country. He's an absolute legend and is with us right here in the studio. G'day, Normie.
Welcome.
Great
to be here.
So what can we expect during some of your upcoming gigs? This is pretty exciting.
We're sort of going back to all of the old hits. I had 11 top 10 records in a row.
11.
Amazing. Yeah. Wow.
And so in a, you know, say a 40-minute set, there's all the songs. But, of course, we do 2 hours and... there's a bit of storyline, there's a bit of the time that I was in Vietnam, a bit of the time since then, being an ex-serviceman. Mm. You know, little family anecdotes and stuff like that.
The whole thing, the complete
map. Yeah, it's a sort of a storyline, a chronology.
Oh, my God, oh gosh, I'm looking at some of this vision. I love that earlier black and white stuff.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Wow, 11 hits.
I'm not talking about the guy in the blue suit.
But there's a lot of the shows that are going in the theatre looking at life stories. Jimmy Barnes has obviously
sure.
got a very, sure. very successful show following on two hugely successful books. Mm. It seems to be the way people want that entertainment now.
Yeah, I think...
value added.
I think in many ways the club thing let itself down a huge amount. And theatre has picked up the slack.
Mm.
My preference is working in theatre anyway. I never worked in a place that served alcohol until I came back from Vietnam, so it had 8 years of working in venues alcohol-free. I never got really into pub rock. I worked a lot in clubs in New South Wales in the 70s, 80s and 90s. And then I went back to drama school with Hayes Gordon, went on to do a play and then in Sons and Daughters. And from Sons and Daughters, I went into... into Les Miserables.
Are there things about you that are going to come out in these shows that people have never heard before? I mean, you've been around for, you know, almost half a century, but is there stuff that...
Almost every show, there are different things that happen. I tend to rely a lot on what the audience is doing, you know? I love the interaction between the crowd and I always go out and visit people after the show. I'll go out and I'll sign autographs.
What do you think is the most surprising thing about you that people might not know?
I tend to think that people know everything that come to see my shows. But what's surprising now is the amount of people who are coming out. It's just wonderful to see. We've got two shows next Monday in Melbourne at the Hamer Hall and they're both almost sold out.
Wow. That's a big venue.
Yeah.
I'm curious too, because you've got that energy. You just keep on keeping on. You mentioned Les Miserables, and of course, so many Australians saw you in that incredible role of Jean Valjean. Do you pop a Les Miserables number in the show?
Sure,
you do.
Sure.
Really?
Wow.
So sure. You know that's the voice going from pop to the full on.
Yeah, and it's pretty hard. I start sweating when that song, when Bring Him Home, is coming
up. So
you
sing Bring Him Home in the
Yeah.
That's a big number.
Yeah.
That's a big number.
And I can't say what I say on stage on television because there might be some kids listening. The high notes are high notes.
You get the high notes.
We've already had Todd McKenney on. We know about his rivalry with Hugh Jackman. You have played the same role as Hugh Jackman. How do you think he went in the film?
I think he did an incredibly great job.
Mm.
He wouldn't have had the same length of period of time in rehearsal and working with the director that we had with Trevor Nunn. But
also it was live to film.
Yeah.
So in his ear, he's got the orchestration and it was their job to follow him in a lot of that.
And I think Anne Hathaway did an incredible job of I Dreamed a Dream. I mean, in one, and it was all shot on one shot,
yep.
not
Not multi-camera. A lot of people said it was a mistake to do it all in one go and do it live because it meant that, Hugh, for example, couldn't necessarily get the best take of what he was doing. Do you think that was a mistake? Or do you
I just think it was different. I don't think it was wrong. I have no criticism about it. I think film is an incredible medium to try and do something like that because you've always, with film, you can always cut and paste and things like that. You can't do that in live theatre, and they've shot that as if it was live theatre. Mm. So that's a really unusual situation.
But he nailed
situation.
It. Yeah. He nailed it.
He did.
And it
he
also had the authenticity.
Job.
It was just like you were on the edge because you knew he couldn't do it again.
Mm. Yeah. The only
Personally,
thing that let
Russell
me down was on that thing was I think that the computer-generated graphics, so all those sort of things just didn't quite make it for me.
We see so many of the jukebox musicals of artists, for instance, Jersey Boys, where the songs of their career tell their story. Have you found that your hits work into telling your own story, that the actual content, lyrical content of the song?
To a certain extent, they
in
do.
A way?
Yeah. It's really important to hit most of the songs.
Yeah.
You know? And I found that I'm singing more of the old songs now than I did in the 70s, 80s, 90s, you know.
Could we see a jukebox musical of the story of Normie Rowe one day?
There has been one done, Normie the Musical. It was done in Melbourne. I believe it's going into another production shortly. Yeah.
But also this afternoon, big afternoon for you, 1927, the band.
Great band.
What's happening?
Well, there's a whole lot of artists getting together to record the individual tracks from their album Ish, which was an icon album, and I'm doing a song called Compulsory Hero, which is a great anthem about being a Vietnam veteran. So
about conscription, because many people might not realise that that you were kind of the Justin Bieber of Australia. You had all these huge hits, and then
he got my haircut.
That's right. But then you were conscripted and sent to this terrible, terrible war, and carried deep scars because of that. But
I guess the thing about that was that there were maybe 50,000 young Australian men who were called up. 25,000 of them went to Vietnam, and there's not one of them without a scar. Mm. And I don't think you can go off to war, and that's why we really need to think about what's happening with our young people coming back from the Middle East these days. You know, we have to look after them.
Absolutely.
That's really important.
Now, Normie's next two gigs are next Monday and Tuesday, October 1st and 2nd. Now, one's is it Hamer Hall?
Hamer Hall
at the Arts Centre in Melbourne, and then November 9 at the Concourse Theatre in Chatswood in Sydney. That's a great venue there. You can head to normierowe.com/events for tickets. Normie Rowe, thank you for your music and also for your service. You're wonderful.
Thanks, Kerri-Anne.